to season two of Non-Beta Alpha. I'm Ryan Morfin. On today's episode, we have Josh Bridges, CEO and founder of Good Dudes Coffee, teaching us what it means to be a good dude and what an excellent cup of coffee looks like. This is Non-Beta Alpha. Joshua, welcome to the show. Thanks for coming on.
Hey, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it. Excited to be on.
So you're the founder of Good Dudes Coffee. And if you could, just give us a little bit of background of who you are and where you're coming from. And we'd love to jump into your product and what's going on in the coffee industry.
Yeah, I am, you know, Josh Bridges. I'm a former Navy SEAL. I am a six-time CrossFit Games athlete. Father of two boys, proud owner of Good Dudes Coffee. So, just a little bit about, that's basically my little backstory.
Yeah. So where are you from? Where'd you grow up?
So I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri, just outside of St. Louis in the suburbs of St. Charles, Missouri. So, grew up there until I joined the Navy in 2007 and then been in San Diego ever since.
Got it. And your time in the Navy, I'm sure you met some good dudes. Maybe tell me a little bit about your experience during your time in Naval Special Warfare.
Yeah, so I was at SEAL Team 3 for two platoons. I ended up actually getting to do three deployments. The first one was directly out of SEAL training, which is SQT, SEAL qualification training, the second phase of becoming a Navy SEAL. I got to go on a deployment directly after I graduated, meeting Chris Cowell was actually my first LPO. So that was really cool. And then did two more deployments, first two deployments were to Iraq and my third and final deployment was to Afghanistan. After that deployment, I went on and became an instructor for 3 years at the training detachment, before I got out.
Got it. And so you're into these like ultra marathons and these kind of high-end performance, you know, races. Where did you pick that up and how did you get into that?
I'm not really in the, I wouldn't say I'm into ultra marathons or anything like that. CrossFit's a little different. It's more functional fitness style working out. You can do ultra races if you need to, but it's not something I particularly do. But yeah, I just got into CrossFit.
You do a lot of CrossFit and you're actually sponsored by Nike. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah. So CrossFit, I got into CrossFit in 2005, a long time ago, just to basically get in shape for becoming a Navy SEAL. A buddy of mine told me, he's like, hey, I'm going to go try to be a Navy SEAL. And this is what some of these guys do to get in shape for it. And it's called CrossFit. And I was like, oh, that sounds pretty cool. I gave it a shot. I wrestled in college. And so after college, I kind of stopped working out, kind of got a little out of shape and, I was a loan officer in the mortgage industry for a few years. And so this guy was like, hey, I'm going to go do this and you want to give it a shot with me? And I said, sure. So CrossFit's really, it's changed my life, to be honest. The transition from wrestling into CrossFit was really simple or really easy because it's like short intervals. And it has a competitive nature to it because it's always do this workout as fast as you can or do as many reps as you can in a certain amount of time. And so I fell in love with it. I loved it. And then used it to train to get ready for my SEAL training or my military training. And then at a certain point while I was in the military, they started a sport out of it, the sport of CrossFit. And I just felt like I was competitive enough and I had time where I could participate in some of the competitions while I was in. And so, and it's been a crazy ride ever since. I took second in the Worldwide Games, which is basically our Super Bowl, in my first year in 2011 and, picked up some great sponsors. Nike's one of them, Rogue Fitness, a lot of great sponsors that, have treated me well and just catapulted my life in a different direction than I ever thought it would be.
So, quick question then: Who works out harder? Is it Jocko or David Goggins? Do you have any opinion on that? or is it you?
I would say me, but no, I'm not. I don't know. I don't know Goggins. I don't know David very well. I've never met him. I know Jocko. Jocko puts out. He's a Jocko's awesome. I love that guy.
Yeah, a lot of our viewers follow him on Instagram, and hopefully they'll be following you too. So I didn't know you were a wrestler in college. Where'd you wrestle?
I wrestled at a small NAIA school in St. Charles, Missouri, Lindenwood University.
That's a great sport. I mean, do you think that prepared you properly for SEAL training?
I tell people this all the time, that I thought college wrestling was more physically demanding to me personally, more physically demanding than BUDS, or basic underwater demolition SEAL training, the SEAL training. It might have been the mindset that I would have, though. You know, when you're going right out of high school into college, you're not prepared and you think you know everything, and you know, you just have a different mindset. And so it might have been, but college wrestling was one of the hardest things physically I've ever done. It was, the practices were grueling. And I definitely think that had a lot to do with how it changed my mindset and prepared myself mentally for what the military had to throw at me.
Is there anything that you do specially for getting ready for a CrossFit competition, like drink a lot of coffee or anything like that?
I drink coffee before my events. I don't drink a lot of it. I do drink some. I try to hydrate. I definitely clean up my nutrition. Eat a little cleaner. I try to stay away from sugary foods. You know, keep anything that causes inflammation out. That's kind of what I try to do. I do a lot of stuff for recovery. I was a big proponent of recovery, and I think that was why, one of the main reasons why I lasted so long in the sport of CrossFit, is because I just took recovery really serious. So.
Well, so you spent your time, and thank you for your service to our country. You spent your time in the teams, and you got out. And tell me a little bit about the founding of Good Dudes Coffee.
Yeah, so Good Dudes Coffee, it was me and two buddies. We were in a garage or a barn, really, and we just finished working out, and we started talking about, you know, doing these training camps. And we were basically going to go around, and we were going to train with people and let people come train with us, which we did for a little bit. And then we had this brand we called Good Dudes. And what the meaning behind Good Dudes is in the military, a good, like, you want to be a good dude. You don't want to be a nice guy. Like, everyone's like, most people are nice guys, right? Nice guy's your neighbor, but a good dude is someone you want to go to war with. And so, we came up with the name Good Dudes and, just ran with it. And so I had always had a passion for coffee. I've always wanted to start a coffee company. And so I thought the name was great. I loved the brand. And so that was really where Good Dudes Coffee really came from. The funny thing was, how I got into coffee was, I thought I was this coffee connoisseur, and you know, I was buying all these specialty coffees from different websites, and I'm in Iraq, right? So I'm in Iraq on my second deployment, and I'm ordering some coffee to be sent out, and I go to this website, and I order, like, I don't know, a couple hundred dollars worth of coffee beans. And when it showed up, it was unroasted, because I didn't realize that when it said green next to the name of the coffee that I was buying, it meant unroasted coffee. Because when you get unroasted coffee beans, it has a greenish tint to it. And so I had, you know, $200 worth of unroasted coffee beans, and I decided I'm like, what do you do with it? So I went and bought a roaster and had it sent out to Iraq and started roasting coffee in Iraq. So that was really where the passion started.
And the Iraqis don't do too much coffee. They're more tea drinkers, I think. So you didn't have any supplies. There were no coffee roasters in Amazon there. So did you guys just make your own equipment to roast the coffee and out of excess equipment you had in the base?
No. I ordered one off of offline. I found a company. It shipped out. You know, it took a few weeks to get there. But it basically looked like a popcorn popper. It was an air roaster, very, very small, very generic, very at home type of roaster. You can only do very small amounts, like quarter pounds at a time. But it was fun. I enjoyed it. And, you know, just playing around and messing with it and trying trying different routes, like how long to roast it and all that kind of stuff. And I had to look up like how to do it, how long to roast it, because I had no idea how to do any of that stuff. So started watching YouTube videos like everyone else.
So how long does it take to roast, you know, coffee? Does it depend on the type of coffee or?
Well, it depends on the type of coffee that you want. It depends on the roaster that you have. I would say, so on the sample roaster I use now, it takes about 6-7 minutes total to roast about 50 grams of coffee. You know, when you're going into a big, more of a big style, you know, 5 to 10 to 15 pound roaster, you know, it's going to take more upwards of about 20 minutes, probably maybe 15 to 20 minutes to roast, you know, that amount of coffee at a time. So it just all depends. And then it depends, you know, if you want to go darker roast, lighter roast, all that kind of stuff plays into it.
So obviously lighter is less time in the roaster, darker is more.
Exactly. And so what you want to know, what you want to realize is a lot of people, it's funny, everyone, one of the questions that you always get asked, or I always ask, like, what kind of coffee do you like? And like, oh, it's always, I like strong coffee. Strong is that famous where everyone wants to use strong. And I understand it, right? But for me, when you say strong coffee, you have to clarify what you mean by that. Do you like strong flavor or do you like high amounts of caffeine in your coffee? And a lot of people don't realize this, but dark roasted coffee has less caffeine content than a light roasted coffee, because you're actually roasting out the caffeine as you roast it longer.
Interesting. So literally the lighter roasted coffees, if you're looking for that pop in the morning, will give you more caffeine.
Exactly. That's going to give you that, you know, that caffeine uptick that you're looking for.
So pretty much everybody that I know and do business with are avid consumers of coffee. A lot of people still go to that, you know, that mermaid place where they, you know, pick up all sorts of public health diseases. But question for you is, you know, what can consumers do? Like, go online and go do a sampling of different bags of coffee. And what would your advice be to consumers today in the coronavirus environment to kind of research or experiment with new coffees?
Yeah, for sure. There's so many different coffee brands out there, right? And I obviously love our coffee at Good Dudes Coffee. I personally hand selected all of them and approved them. They're coffees that I would drink, but there's a lot of different coffees out there. And you know, there's actually some really cool websites that will, like, you don't even know what coffee you're going to get. They'll go around to other coffee companies and send you different brands from out the country. And it's called, you know, I have no affiliation with this company whatsoever. I just think it's a really cool idea. And it's called Trade Coffee. And so, but I think there's a few of them out there. And that's just the first one that I found. So go out there, experiment. Exactly. Try light roast, try dark roast, try different country origins, right? You don't want to get, the thing that you want to stay away from is blends. Typically, when you're getting blends, what you're getting is a bunch of really crappy coffee with a little bit of good coffee sprinkled in. And so, that's why, and why that is because your margins are better, right? So people can make more money with it. When you go with single origins, you might pay a little higher price for that coffee, but it's because the flavor is going to be a lot better. And then once you find certain types of coffee, you realize, okay, maybe you like the Ethiopians or the Kenyans, or maybe you like South American style coffees, you know, the coffees from Brazil or Colombia or Peru, or, you know, there's Panama's out there. And then you have to look at processes, right? This is a lot of information and probably more than people need to know, but there's the different way that the coffee cherry is processed once it's picked off the tree. And there's called washed and then natural. If you like really bright, acidic, you know, you're going to get like almost fruity flavors. You want to go with those natural processes, because what they do is they pick the cherry, they let that coffee bean dry with the cherry still attached to the bean, which is going to change the flavor profile of that bean. And so, and then they remove the cherry from it, and then you get that unroasted coffee bean, and then the companies roast them from there. And it's just that those, you can get some wild, wild flavors out of natural processed coffee beans. So play with that too.
Is all coffee organic? I mean, it seems to me that it would be, but I mean, can they put preservatives in there to screw it up?
Yeah, no, not all coffee is organic. You have to definitely like, you know, if you want to go that route, go that route. You know, I don't think you have to be honest. I mean, I do some organic coffees, you know, but not all of the coffees. We offer one organic coffee bean for people who are, you know, very strict with that kind of thing. So fair trade is really good. That means you're talking about, you're dealing with people who are directly dealing with the coffee farmers, because a lot of times the farmers are the ones who don't, who actually get the least amount of money out of this process. And so what's happening now is you're seeing a lot of coffee roasters going directly to coffee farmers, right? Those typically like direct to farm fair trade style coffee beans. And that means that basically those farmers are out there and they're actually making the money that they deserve to make, because they're the ones that are producing the coffee beans.
Are there any domestic production of coffee in the United States?
So there's one, and two technically. You got Hawaii. Hawaii is the one and only really in domestic, but then you have, as of recently, they're trying to produce coffee in Southern California, and one farm did it, and it's actually Jason Mraz. You know the singer, Jason Mraz? It's his family's coffee farm, and that was last year. They actually had a little harvest in a small batch. So yeah, that was actually really cool to see. And I think at some point they'll figure it out and it'll be better. But yeah, so that's the only two.
And interesting, is it so hard because of the climate, or is there the soil, or?
Yeah, exactly. It's all of the above, right? The soil, the altitude, the weather's got to be perfect. And so basically there's a coffee belt that wraps around the equator, and that's where the coffee can grow. And so that's why you get, you know, you have like, if you look on a map, and basically it's a, you know, however many degrees above and however many degrees below, there's this belt that wraps around where all the coffee comes from in the world.
And what are your two favorite countries of origin for coffee?
So I'll give you three, because
you can't pick a favorite child.
I can't pick two out of these three. So Ethiopians are my favorite. Like, hands down, if I walk into a coffee shop, I typically go with an Ethiopian. And then you have Panama is really coming out with some amazing coffees. And then my last one is Burundi's. And those can be really good if they're good, but they can also be really bad if they're not good. So I always tend to try them if I see them in a store, because they're not carried very often.
And so you buy your beans and you get them roasted here in the United States?
Yes. Yeah, we roast up in Connecticut. Up in Connecticut as of right now.
Very good. And so once you roast them, you get your different flavors, if you will, your different types. You package them, and then tell me a little bit about, you know, a lot of our folks, our viewers are also business people. So tell me a little bit about the marketing approach, like your go-to-market approach. Like, how is that? Is it online? Is it retail? Is it both?
Yeah, as of right now, we're pretty much all online. You know, we're only a little over a year. We're basically 13 months old, and you know, we had the cool part is that the three of us already came in with a platform, and so, you know, we all have a following from our CrossFit days, and plus my military background. And so we had this platform. And so that was kind of what we started with our marketing, was just us marketing it as ourselves. Like, hey, this is our coffee, you know, come try it. And then, you know, now we're trying to reach broader audiences other than just the CrossFit world. And so, yeah, the marketing's huge. It's big. It's, you know, that's the thing about marketing is, you can sell it just because people want to be associated with the brand. And so that's really been a eye opening for me, is you'll see people's coffee companies that are doing really well, and you're like, man, I've had that coffee. It's not very good, but people just want to be associated with certain brands that do good things. And so that's really isn't one of the reasons why we do this, but we like to give back. I personally love to give back to military services. And so we do a lot of work where all of our bags are named after someone that we think is a good dude. And so, you know, we have the Roosevelt, the Reagan, the Washington, the Lincoln, the Samson. The Samson's actually a really cool story. Deborah Sampson. The bag is actually named after a woman, Deborah Sampson. And she was in the Civil War, and she dressed as a man to fight for, you know, the Revolutionary War. I said civil. The Revolutionary War. She disguised as a man so she could fight in the war. And the only reason she got found out is because she got shot in the hip. And as she was, you know, getting to her medically, getting taken care of medically, they found out she was a man or a woman. And so it was really
imagine the doctor's surprise.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So
Deborah seems like a good dude to me.
Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, we do a lot of stuff where we worked with the Pat Tillman Foundation, where we give 100% of not only the proceeds, but everything, 100% of sales to those foundations, just to give back. And, you know, the military has given me so much, and, you know, what it's done for our country and what it's done for everyone in the country has been a blessing for us. And we have a lot of veterans out there that are struggling mentally. And there's so many great foundations that we can, you know, help perpetuate with our brand. And so it's been a really cool thing for us to do that.
So to go a little deeper down the coffee rabbit hole with you, so do you prefer, you know, like a drip coffee or pour over? Any thoughts on the benefits of each?
Yeah, I personally love a pour over, and I love espresso. And I think that, you know, that all comes down to taste, right? So that was actually the other thing I wanted to talk about earlier was, yeah, the methods of brewing, right? You have drip. For me, drip, there are good drip machines out there. They're a little pricier than, you know, your Mr. Coffees, but.
Well, I'm going to ask you to name some names on this one. So what would be a great like drip machine that you think would blow people's socks off? Cause I think a lot of people, they don't realize that they just, you know, make the coffee in the morning, go in the office, don't think about it. And I think what you said it earlier, like if you're going to do something, be excellent at it. So if we want to get the gear to be excellent at coffee, like what's the gear you'd recommend people go after?
So on the drip, I'm not very good at that. I can't remember the name of the machine, and I'm going to try to think of it before we get off here. I'll try to think of it. But okay. If I was going to start, I would start with a pour over, and it's really simple. You get a Hario V60. That's a super simple. You got to get a filters for that. And then you have to basically just get a kettle. Having a temperature kettle that shows you what the water temperature is big. Because if you boil water and then pour it on your grounds, that water will actually burn the grinds. So if you get water if you don't have a kettle that has temperature gauge on it, you want to basically brew like 195 to 205. Is typically where you want to stay, degrees Fahrenheit. If you don't have that, boil your water and then let it rest for about a minute, you know, and that should bring that water temp back down to where it wants to be. You don't want to pour boiling hot water on your coffee grounds. It's going to ruin the flavor of the coffee. And that's really it. It's really simple for a pour over. There's another great process. Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
No, I was just saying, just any cuisine art type of kettle, doesn't matter really. Just get it hot.
Yeah, the gooseneck kettles can kind of help with, it's called blooming the grounds and dispersing it. You're getting really like, you know, like this is getting really into the weeds here with it, but you don't have to have a gooseneck kettle, but if you can, it's not a bad idea. It just helps you evenly distribute the water over the grounds. And so then you have an AeroPress. An AeroPress is another process. It makes like a really concentrated cup of coffee. So it's a little thicker, or a little more flavor, right? It's for people who like that heavy taste, heavy flavored coffee. It's basically you're going to pour your grounds in. It's a plastic tube. And it's really cheap. They're like $20. They're not expensive. And they're great to travel with because when you're traveling, you know, you're stuck going to, you know, getting hotel coffee or whatever. And it's
that mermaid place. Ugh. Yeah.
So I travel with my coffee and I typically travel with my AeroPress. It's a really easy process. You get little filters on there as well. Just go to aeropress.com, I think, or look it up on Amazon. It's all on there. It's simple. Same thing. You're going to want to have a scale because what you want to have is consistency. So you want to have the same number of grounds to the same number of water that you pour through the grounds. And when you're doing a pour over, you're going to go like 1:15, 1:16, 1:14 ratio. That is coffee grounds to water ratio. So if I put in 20 grams of coffee, I'm going to pour 320 grams of water on that. And so having a scale just helps make it consistent so that you always get that same great flavor that you want.
Got it.
Or you can go French press.
So talk to me about French press. So, I mean, does that just get too oily, do you think? Or what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of French press. For me, it does. It gets really oily. It's a really dirty, like dirty is probably the best word to describe it, because you'll see that layer of like oil on top of the coffee. It has that distinct flavor. Sometimes you'll even get some of the grinds into your cup of coffee. So I'm not a huge fan of that. Some people are. It is, again, it's all up to you as you know, you're the captain of your own cup of coffee. So whatever you want to drink.
Well, you would hope so, because if you're not, then you got to start making choices for yourself, become an adult here. So tell me about the espresso, your choice of espresso makers. Like, maybe let's talk about entry level, and let's talk about, hey, I'm an adult, I can afford a nice coffee espresso maker for my office.
Yeah. So, you know, if you're at home, you got a couple different options, right? You have some manual ones. There's a great one called Flair Espresso. It's a manual press that really makes, if you dial that thing in, you can make a phenomenal cup of coffee. It's like $300. It's not bad at all. I would not buy anything cheaper than like $300, other than something that's manual. But like, if you're like, Breville doesn't make it's not a bad cup of coffee. I don't think it holds the right amount of pressure that you need to make a great espresso, but it's not bad. It's definitely drinkable. And then once you get into the big boys, right, you're going to start upwards of like $1,000, $2,000 to $5,000. You can start with like a Rocket Espresso is a decent espresso maker. I think that starts at like $1,000 to $2,000 up to, then you have like a La Marzocco Lima Mini, which is what I have. And they're, now you're looking at spending, this is exactly like, it took me a few years to pull the trigger on it. I was like, I don't know, but then I really love it. So, you know, that's upwards of like 5,000. So that could go into an office for sure. Something like that. So there's a lot of different options out there. But those are probably your basic tiers.
And when you're looking at espresso, you know, grinds, and I mean, do you, the prepackaged pellets, or do you think you still need the powder and measure it out? What are your thoughts on that?
I would never use a packet. I would never use like an espresso.
Blasphemy.
It's just not it's not good coffee. And so, yeah,
coffee blasphemy.
The moment you grind coffee, you have about 20 minutes before it actually starts to go stale. So if you buy ground coffee at a supermarket, that coffee has been stale for a while, because there's no way that they just ground it.
So when you're buying, I've never bought espresso beans, but you can go order espresso beans online.
And
you know, to be honest, there are traditional espresso style beans, which is going to be a darker, because espresso comes from Italy, and the traditional style of Italian espressos are really dark, and it's a really dark roast. Nowadays though, to be honest, I actually use our lightest roast in my espresso beans. I use our Reagan, and it really brings out some crazy flavors in your espresso. So again, there's no one tells you exactly how you have to do this stuff. That's what's so cool about coffee. There are some guidelines that are created to help you so that you don't ruin coffee and waste it, but you can play and do and try different things and try different ratios, and you never know, maybe you'll make a great cup of coffee by accident. So I try lighter roast on my espresso so that you don't have to buy espresso beans to make an espresso.
Well, and so you get the beans, and what grinder, what gear do you need to get them grounded up properly?
Yeah. So for espresso, you got to go really super fine. So you have to have a good grinder, and it can't be a blade grinder, because a blade grinder chops the bean up. It's basically going to give you an uneven extraction, which is going to give you bad flavor. So you need to get a burr grinder, B-U-R-R, and that's a type of grinder. It's not a model of grinder or anything. It's basically there's like a burr. It looks like a screw in the machine, and that's how it grinds up your coffee beans. It's going to grind it up very evenly and it can grind it up, grind it very fine. And so any burr grinder out there, as long as it's, you know, decent, should be able to get you down into that finer grinder. The more expensive you probably pay for a grinder, you're gonna, the better it's gonna perform. There's actually a hand grinder that does a really good job, and it's called the Comandante. That's like the Cadillac of hand grinders. It's a beautiful thing. It's a little more pricey, it's a little pricier. It's like $250 or whatever, but it's worth it because it does coarse, very coarse ground, and then it can go all the way down to very fine grounds. And so you just have to dial it in.
And what about electric grinders? Any naming any names on that front?
La Marzocco makes a great one if you're going top end espresso maker, you might as well get a top end espresso grinder. And so La Marzocco, the espresso machine, they also make their grinder too. So that's what I have.
Got it. Well, I'll have to check that out. This is going to be a very expensive episode for me. And so as it relates to, you know, any other gear that people need to think about if they want to make a really serious, you know, wow cup of coffee?
I think, you know, that's really, those are some of your main, even ones. There's things called the siphon. A siphon's a really cool way to make coffee. It's a little bit more of a mess. It has a lot more cleanup than like your pour overs or your AeroPress, because basically what it is you're going to put your grounds in the top. It looks almost like an hourglass, and you'll put grounds in the top, and then you're going to have water underneath. And then as you heat the water up on the stove, the water actually goes up and percolates up into the top, sits with the water. And then when you take it off the heat, it comes back down. So now you have to clean out the whole glass process, but it does make a really good cup of coffee. So, again, if you want to get really crazy and start trying a bunch of different stuff, the siphon is actually a really cool way to make coffee as well.
What have you ever looked at or grabbed coffee from the Clover Press that Starbucks has?
Yeah. That's a cool, it's a kind of, a total immersion coffee where the coffee and the ground or the water and the grind sit together for a little bit. And then then you basically sit it on top of your coffee mug and it drains through. It's kind of like a AeroPress a little bit, except for it's a combination of an AeroPress and a pour over at the same time. So I have used that. So yeah, again, it's going to give you just a little, you know, you're going to get some more of that oil in there because it's sitting with the coffee instead of just draining through like a pour over does.
No, this has been phenomenal. So how do you take your coffee? You take it cream and sugar or just black?
Just black. I don't, a buddy of mine, when I first started drinking coffee, was like, we drink our coffee black. And I was like, fair enough. And so I never got a taste for putting cream or sugar or anything like that in my coffee. So I've always gone black. I think once you start to, and you start to drink good coffees, you don't really need that stuff. It's a lot of sugar. It's a lot of fat. It's, you know, black coffee really has like 3 calories. And so it's great. You can actually, I mean, even if you're doing fasting, you can drink coffee technically without ruining your fast. So yeah, I go black with my coffee.
Tell me any health benefits that any coffee production associations have, you know, sponsored. Like, what are the benefits of drinking coffee? I think it just keeps me on my game and wakes me up in the morning. But what are your thoughts about, you know, drinking a cup of coffee?
You know, there's a lot of different thoughts on that, I guess, on health benefits, good, bad. I think everything in moderation is fine, right? I think caffeine's good for me. It helps me focus. Like you said, you know, it gets me on my game. It helps me to let my brain not be so cloudy. You know, are there actual health benefits? I don't know. You know, like, I'm not a nutritionist. I've never studied it. So I don't want to sit here and be like, oh, you know, I've read this and this and this and this. But, you know, there's a lot of different sayings on it, or a lot of different thoughts on it. So, like I said, everything in moderation. But I don't think it's that bad for you. I think that if you, you know, have a lot of anxiety, maybe should you drink a little less coffee? Sure. You know, but
is there such a thing as too much coffee? I don't believe that, but do you think there is?
I try not to drink coffee too late in the day. That's just me personally, because I need my sleep. You know, as an athlete, I know how important sleep is. And so for me, I try not to disrupt my sleep by drinking coffee after, say, 2 p.m. So a lot of people would say it should probably even be earlier than that, but I stick to 2 p.m. is if I haven't had, I can have a cup of coffee up to 2 p.m. After that, I cut myself off with caffeine.
So as it relates to the industry, you know, these, you know, we'll call smaller producers and new brands that are emerging in the coffee industry, a lot of them have like this double bottom line social impact component. But how has the industry been since the pandemic? People aren't going to Starbucks as much as they used to. Are you seeing, you know, sales start to blossom? And what are your thoughts about, you know, the industry for coffee going forward?
Yeah, I think it's a great industry. I think that it's, you know, this whole third wave coffee is doing great things. It's bringing good coffee to everyone out there. A lot of people have grown up with drinking either, you know, Maxwell House or U-Ban, you know, that those old 10 cups. And then, you know, Pete's and Starbucks came in and those, you know, kind of took over from the Maxwell Houses. And now you're seeing a bunch of third wave coffee companies that are coming in and bringing amazing coffee out there. And so that's really huge. And I think that the industry is only going to go up because you're getting more people involved, more people to change the processes and flavor profiles of different coffee beans. So it's really exciting where coffee's going. For us, yes, the pandemic has actually made our sales go up. It was very noticeable right off the bat. You know, we do a subscription to where you can order, say, if you need 2 pounds every week, we'll send you 2 pounds every week. And it just shows up at your door. It's an auto renew subscription. And so you don't have to worry about running out of coffee and being like, man, ah, crap, I got to put that order in and then still wait, you know, however many days it takes for the coffee to get to you. You know, you always have your coffee coming to you, which is nice, right? You don't have to go spend exactly $5 every cup for a cup of coffee at that place down the street that nobody likes.
Yeah, that mermaid place. I mean, they're ripping people off and people keep paying it because they need the fix. But I think if you can make it easy for them to get access to it and educate them, that it's more of an art than a conformity, I think people will start to appreciate it. So a question for you. I mean, who makes the best cup of coffee in the world? Is it Americans, Italians, Colombians, Turks, Australians? I mean, who do you think's perfected the cup of coffee?
You know, I have a hard time going against the U.S. right now. We have a lot of really people who are getting really deep into the coffee business and going down these crazy paths with the processes and stuff like that. So it's really cool. It's really cool to see. And, you know, I haven't traveled too much. A little bit of coffee in Europe, but I haven't found the type of coffee that we have here. And so I'd have to stick with the U.S.
I would agree. Question for you as it relates to, you know, the coffee industry. I mean, you're starting to see, you know, new competitors come in like Ascension, and you got Starbucks, and then there's this Chinese knockoff that's got looks exactly the same. Do you think the consumer eventually gets tired of these big brands and it will start to go niche? And I guess that's probably your hope, but, you know, what are the inflection points in your industry that, you know, the kind of the trends that you're seeing for this niche coffee market?
I think right now the convenience factor, you have to educate people, right? For people to understand how easy and how quick you can actually make really good cups of coffee at your house for and how much money you'd actually save, where people are paying for convenience right now. They're going to those places, you know, that you just mentioned because it's convenient. It's right down the street. It doesn't take that long, but they're willing to spend the extra couple dollars because of the convenience factor. If we can educate these people that how fast you can actually make a really good cup of coffee that really doesn't take that long in the morning, not only are you going to save money, but you're going to have better coffee in your cup, right? Which is great for everyone. So right now, you know, that's two pluses. So I think that if we can get the education out and show, that's kind of what we're trying to do with our marketing is, right, we're trying to teach people how quickly you can make an AeroPress, how quickly you can make a pour over in the morning. We're doing videos and showing them and basically saying, like, and say you don't have all this fancy equipment, you don't have a scale, that's fine. So all you need is a teaspoon, and like, you basically, you know, just be consistent with how much coffee ground you're putting into it. So I think education is the key. And once we get the word out there to the masses, then people can understand that it's not that hard. It doesn't take that much time. It's just as convenient and it's cheaper and it's better.
So run me through your product list. I know you got iced coffee and you got the Reagan. Talk to me a little bit about, you know, your range of products.
Yeah. So right now we're offering It's called Snap Shield, and that's a cold brew. I'm not a cold coffee type of guy, but a lot of people are. A lot of people like cold coffee, and it's in a can, so it's convenient. Again, same thing. Convenience is what a lot of people are looking for. How it's brewed, though, most cold coffee is brewed very slow, and it becomes very bitter and has a little flavor. I think it all tastes the same. Ours is actually brewed hot, snap chilled, and then put in the can, so it keeps that flavor, and it's really great. It's a really great, convenient way to drink cold brew. Then we offer 5 different bags. We have the Reagan, which is a Panama. It's our lightest roast. We have the Roosevelt, which is an Ethiopian, and that is like a light medium roast. It has some really good flavor notes in there. It's a really great cup of coffee as well. And then you're going to go into a little bit more of our medium darks. You have the Lincoln. That's our organic fair trade coffee. That is a Peruvian. And then we have the Washington, which is a Guatemalan, another medium dark roast. Really smooth cups of coffee. They're just not quite as bright as those lighter roasts. And then we have our Samson, which is our darkest roast. For people who have that taste for what I like to say is, hey, do you like your coffee to taste like coffee? You know, because that's the only way to really describe it. It's a very caramelized, smoky flavor, a little bitter because it's roasted really heavy, you know, roasted really long. And so, but people have that because they grew up with that flavor. So that's what they want to taste. So we have to have an option for them. And so that's what we have the Samson for. And that's from Colombia. But they're all single origin coffees, no blends.
Well, fantastic. Well, I'm going to definitely get on Amazon and start ordering some, you know, equipment here just so I can save money and save time. That'll be my excuse. So I don't have to wait in line and eventually I'll save money on this, I'm sure. But what are some things that leave you, I'll say optimistic about, you know, today, you know, as a veteran, as an entrepreneur, your insights as to where we are as a country, what are some silver linings you see?
Yeah, I think right now the country, if you look in the media, you'd think the country was burning down, but, I'm an optimistic guy. I don't like to read the news headlines sometimes. I think that, people are trying to push certain agendas for certain reasons. And, if you go out and around and you actually talk to people, there's a lot of great people out there doing a lot of great things. And our country is just, it's not in a bad place, right? If you look at the stock market's up. Our economy is doing well. Yeah, the unemployment rate's down because of this pandemic, but hopefully when the pandemic ends, things are gonna come back around. And I think they always will because, we're the United States and man, we don't like to lose. So I'm very optimistic about our country.
Back-to-back World War champions. Yeah, we don't like to lose. Do you think there's any correlation between coffee consumption and GDP growth?
Could be. Yeah, I think so.
I think even if it is fake news, I like it. what are you doing to educate yourself as an entrepreneur, as a leader? Like what podcasts, what books, what are you doing to kind of entertain yourself when you're not in your business?
Yeah, it's hard. My business is, I try to educate myself as much as possible. Right now I'm spread a little thin. So my learning isn't where it probably should be because I'm still training if I want to compete. I'm doing my own podcast. We're doing a YouTube channel. So a lot of different things going
on. What's the name of the podcast?
It's Checking In, the Josh Bridges podcast. We've only released four episodes. I'm talking to a lot of my ex-military buddies, talking about, I have a lot of good friends who are doing a lot of great things with the mental health issue that, a lot of our veterans are dealing with. And so we're talking a lot about that kind of stuff, talking about the CrossFit world, kind of just talking about everything. It's a very well-rounded, I think, show. It doesn't have a specific focus. A good listen for people who want to be entertained and maybe hear some people's thoughts on being mentally prepared for situations and things like that. So yeah, I'm having a lot of fun with that. It's been a really good time to just sit and chat with really intelligent people and listen to them and learn from them. So I've had a great time with it. It's doing well right now.
Fantastic. Are you going to do any YouTube videos and commercials or movies?
I'm not going to do any movies. We got some We do. I have a YouTube channel. So, you know, just type in my name, Josh Bridges, and you can find it. It's a lot of me training and talking about mindset. I just think that people have people can, like, right now, I feel like where the state is with, like, social media and people, I feel like depression is at probably like an all-time high because you're constantly comparing yourself to other people on social media, things like that, and how you can get away from that and how you can get away from having a sense of entitlement, because it's the worst thing anyone can have. You go out and you get what you earn. We talk a lot about, you know, that kind of stuff on that YouTube channel. So yeah, just for, I learned a lot. I had a lot of great mentors in my military time. A lot of great men who did a lot of great things and, you know, changed my perspective in a lot of ways. And it's been a huge thing for me. And I just want to pass that along to anybody who wants to hear it.
What's one or two songs that get you motivated when you're doing your CrossFit competition? Are you able to listen to music while you're doing it, or is it something you just got to zone in?
In training, I listen to music, and the song I always love is Led Zeppelin, When the Levee Breaks. It's a fantastic one. Another song, the AC/DC, you know, Thunderstruck, always a great one. I'm a classic rock type of guy, so.
Fantastic. Well, Josh, thank you for your service. Thank you for coming on the episode today, educating me and our viewers about what a good dude is and a good cup of coffee looks like. And we'd love to have you back on in the future. And we'll definitely hyperlink all this and give people a way to follow you. Can you give everybody a quick shout out on what your website is so they can find you online?
Yeah, for sure. Thank you so much. You can find the coffee at gooddudescoffee.com. Head over there, grab yourself some coffee, and, you know, go brew you up a great cup of coffee. I appreciate it. Thank you so much for having me on. I really had a great time.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Have a great day. Thanks for watching Non-Beta Alpha. And before we go, please remember to subscribe, like, and follow us on our YouTube channel, Spotify, and podcast. This is Non-Beta Alpha. And now, you know.
All price references and market forecasts correspond to the date of this recording. This podcast should not be copied, distributed, published, or reproduced in whole or in part. The information contained in this podcast does not constitute research or recommendation from Non-Beta Alpha Inc., Wentworth Management Services LLC, or any of their affiliates to the listener. Neither Non-Beta Alpha Inc., Wentworth Management Services LLC, nor any of their affiliates make any representation or warranty as to the accuracy or completeness of the statements or any information contained in this podcast, and any liability, therefore, including in respect of direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage, is expressly disclaimed. The views expressed in this podcast are not necessarily those of Non-Beta Alpha Inc. or Wentworth Management Services LLC, and Non-Beta Alpha Inc. and Wentworth Management Services LLC are not providing any financial, economic, legal, accounting, or tax advice or recommendations in this podcast. In addition, the receipt of this podcast by any listener is not to be taken as constituting the giving of investment advice by Non-Beta Alpha Inc. or Wentworth Management Services LLC to that listener, nor to constitute such person a client of any affiliate of Non-Beta Alpha Inc. or Wentworth Management Services LLC. This does not constitute an offer to buy or sell any security. Investments in security may not be suitable for all investors. An investment of any security may involve risk and the potential loss of your initial investment. Investors should review all risk factors before investing. Investors should perform their own due diligence before considering any investment. Past performance is not indicative of future results. Investment products, insurance, and annuity products are not FDIC insured, not bank guaranteed, not insured by a federal government agency, may lose value.